sort of good things here. So we'd like for you to turn in your Bibles here, and let's go back here to 1 John here in chapter 3. One man told me, he said, you know, the book of James, Martin Luther had a hard time with, and he thought it was the epistle of straw, because he could not reconcile the fact Romans says, but to him that worketh not, but believeth on him that justifieth the ungodly, his faith is counted for righteousness. And then James says, if a man say he hath faith and hath not works, his faith is dead. So Martin Luther had a rough time with that. Well, you come to some verses here in 1 John and make James seem like a wonderful Sunday school teacher compared to some of these. But they're really not that difficult once you begin to get the understanding here of what John is writing about and to. First of all, always keep this in mind. 1 John is written to Christians. That's the very first thing we need to realize. The second thing you need to realize is, and we'll see this as we go on down here, is that when you're saved, you have the indwelling of the Holy Spirit of God. That is the third person of the Trinity dwelling within you. The third thing that has to be realized is, number one, the old nature that you were born with prior to accepting Jesus Christ as your Savior is the same old nature that you have after you're saved, and also you are, as a Christian, capable of doing anything after you're saved that you did before you're saved. So sometimes we'll see somebody and say, well, I'm a Christian, and then they live like the devil. That can be true, but there are some consequences to that. But that is true. And it depends upon who you yield to, and we're going to see as John comes on down here and begins to tell us these things. So let's go here, if you will, here, and go to verse 10, all right? Well, we'll go to verse 9 here and pick it up there, and then we'll expound on verse 10. First of all, in verse 9, whosoever is born of God doeth not commit sin. Mark this in your Bible. This is speaking of the Holy Spirit within you, because we know that John had written previously in the first chapter, verse 8, if we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves and the truth is not in us. It is the Holy Spirit that never commits a sin. For his seed remaineth in him. That seed is the Holy Spirit. Then, and he cannot sin because he is born of God. That's a positional truth. In God's eyes, he looks upon you as though you have never sinned positionally now, because he has given you and me the righteousness of Jesus Christ. Practically, we do sin down here. Now, the reason he says positionally, the reason it's positionally is, the sin that you commit after you're a Christian is eternally paid for on the cross by the death of Christ, so that eternally you will never suffer the consequences of hell for any sin you do after you're saved. But you will suffer the consequences down here. Plus, you will suffer the consequences of loss of rewards at the judgment seat of Christ. So we want rewards in heaven. I don't just want a home in heaven. I want some furniture up there too. That depends upon who you yield to. So we find out in verse 9, we have the Holy Spirit that never sins and will pursue you to follow his leading and not the leading of the flesh. Now let's go on down in verse 10. In this, the children of God are manifest and the children of the devil. Whosoever doeth not righteousness is not of God, neither he that loveth not his brother. When a Christian sins, it's not of God. Well, we know that. But let's look at the first part of that and expound on that just a little bit. In this, the children of God are manifest and the children of the devil, depending upon the type of life you lead. Now, if I lead a life that's not pleasing unto God, am I literally a child of Satan? Well, no, you're not. You're still a child of God. You're still there. Because in John chapter 1, verse 12, as many as received him, to them gave he the power to become the sons of God, even to them that believe on his name. I'm a child of God. Do I ever lose that? No. I'm promised eternal life. And God, in Titus chapter 1, in verse 2, said, in whom God that cannot lie. So when God gave me eternal life by trusting Jesus Christ as my Savior, I will never lose that eternal life. Now I can lose my life physically, as they did in 1 Corinthians chapter 11. Many of you are weak, sickly, and dead. because you have not judged in yourselves not to be condemned with the world. So God can take a Christian home prematurely. But the point we want to make here now, we're manifested, and you'll look at somebody who says they're a Christian, and they're not living like a Christian, you figure, well, they're just a big hypocrite, and they are, and they're probably a child of the devil. They could be, or they could not be. But they could be living like the child of a devil. And I want to give you some illustrations of that. Now, first of all, we're going to establish the fact that when you sin, you never lose your eternal life. You never do that. Hold your place here and go with me to Hebrews here. Let's go over to Hebrews chapter 12. We'll hit a couple of these real fast and then give you an illustration of a couple that lived like the child of Satan. But they weren't. They were saved. But, oh boy, they sure weren't living that way. In Hebrews chapter 12, you find out here are some Christians that were sinning. And they were sinning so much continually that God had to chasten them. And just like your children, and God says this in Proverbs chapter 3, He said, "The Lord chasteth His children just as a father His children whom He loveth." So you love your children, you want to teach them to obey you because you know it's the best thing, because you're telling them the right things, and they need to listen to you as their parents. God said, "I'm telling you the things in the Bible here that are going to prosper you, the things that are going to be good for you, the things that I can bless you for, and if you don't listen and continually will not pay attention to what I'm trying to tell you as my child, then I'm going to chasten you." And God will do that. So we come down here now, like for you to notice here in verse 5, where we pick it up. "You have forgotten the exhortation which speaketh unto you as unto children, my son." Now remember, you become a son of God when you trust Jesus Christ as your Savior. Now this universal teaching that you have in all your liberal churches around here in this ecumenical trash, that we are all sons of God, you are not all sons of God. You only become related to God and are born into the family of God when you're born from above. Not below, but above. And that is putting your faith in Jesus Christ. Now when we do that, he says here, his children, and you'll notice here, he's going to chasten his children now here because of sin. But he still calls them his son. Now, he says here in verse 5, "My son, despise not thou the chastening of the Lord, nor faint when thou art rebuked to him." What does he call a Christian here? Don't faint when you're rebuked to the Lord. The Lord's going to chasten you. Are you still a son of God? You sure are. God never kicks you out of the family. Now, let me say this to you. I remember years ago a deacon that was at the Troy Baptist Temple, a church we attended in Ohio. He was relating a story to me. He said, "You know," he said, "a friend of mine who believed that you could lose your salvation." And he said he had a tragic happen in his family. His daughter was 17 years old and became pregnant by one of the school teachers there in the school in her senior year. And they were heartbroken. And my friend related to him. He said, "Let me ask you a question. Did you kick her out of the family?" Oh, he said, "Well, I wouldn't even think about it. I wouldn't even think about it at all." He said, "Why ask such a foolish question?" He said, "Oh, our hearts are broken for her to be pregnant by this teacher. It was a sinful thing to do. It was a wrongful thing to do." But he said, "No, she's going to live with us until the baby's born, and then we'll have to go on from there." He said, "But you didn't kick her out of the family." He said, "Well, of course not. Why are you asking me that?" He said, "Well, let me ask you a question. You say that you can lose your salvation and God will kick you out of the family if you sin. Let me ask you something. Are you telling me that you love your children more than God loves His?" He said, "I see what you mean. No, I don't." He said, "That's a good, good point. You couldn't get out of your everlasting life if you tried. There is no sin you can do after you're saved that will make God a liar that He promised you that you would never perish but have eternal life. Now, you can do things in your life that are sinful that will ruin your life. It can ruin your marriage. It can ruin you physically. It can ruin you in all different ways. But God says here, using this illustration, you're still my son." How many of you ever had to correct your children? See your hand? If you've had children, I'll tell you, I'll guarantee you've had to correct them, haven't you? And you wonder, does it ever do any good? Well, I'll tell you what, any of you ever just kick them out? Well, not really. You love them, but you correct them. Are they still your son? They still bear your name? Absolutely. Absolutely. Let's go on down. Five times he says this, "For whom the Lord loveth, he chasteneth and scourgeth every son whom he receiveth." You're still a son of God. "If you endure chastening, God dealeth with you as with sons. For what son is he whom the father chasteneth not?" You're still a son of God. You see. So when we're talking back here, and what John is speaking about, you're manifested either as the children of God or the children of Satan. One of the two. Now, when these are sinning here, they're sure not manifesting themselves to somebody who's looking at them, or your neighbor, or someone who claims to be a Christian. They could very well be a Christian, but not leading the Christian life. Are they saved? Yes, they're saved. But they're living like the devil, aren't they? You ever know somebody like that? Well, sure. Maybe we have been partakers ourselves in a few things at a few times. We're not taking testimonies this morning, but I'm sure that there's times when we haven't lived like the Lord wants us to live. So we come on down and look at something else. Go with me in your Bibles to 1 Corinthians now, if you will, in chapter 3. 1 Corinthians here in chapter 3. Now, Paul was writing to those in Corinth. They were probably some of the most... Now, they had trusted Christ as their Savior, but they were not living like Christ wanted them to live. So in chapter 3, he tells them to assure them the same thing as Hebrews chapter 12 does, and also in 1 John chapter 3. But notice here in verse 11, "For other foundation can no man lay than that which is laid, which is Christ Jesus." Now, he's speaking to Christians now. How do we know that? Well, let's go back here to chapter 1. All right, let's go here to chapter 1 and begin to look at who he's speaking to. Notice here, he's writing in verse 2, "Unto the church of God, which is at Corinth, to them that are sanctified." The word sanctified, you need to mark in your Bible, means in the Greek, set apart. Why? Because they have trusted Christ as their Savior. They're set apart from the world. They're believers now. But they're sure not going to be living like it. "Sanctified in Christ Jesus, called saints, with all that in every place call upon the name of Jesus Christ our Lord, both theirs and ours." So he's writing unto Christians that live in Corinth. So he comes back here now. "If any man," in verse 12, "that's any Christian, build upon this foundation," no lost person builds upon the foundation of Christ because they don't have Christ. But the Christian does. Now, any Christian can build upon this foundation two things: gold, silver, precious stones, or wood, hay, and stubble. The gold, precious, silver, precious stones represent your good works, the things that God wants you to do. The wood, hay, and stubble represents the things that we are disobedient to the Lord, and they're going to burn at the judgment seat of Christ. Now, we come up here to verse 14 to get the summary of it. "If any man or any Christian's work abide, which he hath built thereupon, he shall receive a reward." Remember, heaven is never a reward. It is a gift. It's fought for by the death of Christ on the cross. It's offered not for anything you do, because all of our good works are nothing but a pile of filthy rags in God's sight, but it's offered as a gift. It's bought and paid for by the blood of Jesus Christ, who came from heaven, died on the cross, offers it to you and I, to anybody in the world, as a free gift. "For by grace are we saved through faith, not of ourselves. It is the gift of God, not of works, lest any man should boast." Then he goes on. Now, what if the Christian doesn't obey the Lord? What if the Christian has a lot of sin in their life? Notice what it says in verse 15. "If any man's work shall be burned, he shall suffer loss, but he himself shall be saved, yet so as by fire." Fire showing the pureness. Just as it's used in the smelting, therefore, the ore and so forth, where the dross comes to the top, and the pure ore is there melted and so forth, where they can use it. But the dross and impurities come to the top. Fire represents God in his judgment, but his righteous judgment, absolutely righteous. So, if any man shall suffer loss, he shall be saved, he himself shall be saved. So, you can have bad works in your life after you're a Christian, but you'll never make God a liar and take away your eternal life. You're still saved. Now, when you're not serving the Lord, you may wish you wasn't saved, because there's a lot of things not going to go right in your life. But bringing this back to 1 John now, let's go on back here. Let's go back here to 1 John, all right? And then we'll take off again here. So, who, in verse 10, "In this the children of God are manifested," by what? By the way you live. Now, Also, we find out, whosoever the children are manifest and the children of the devil. Now, you can appear to be living like the children of the devil. And the devil does have his children. But a Christian can live like the devil if you obey the old flesh. Now, let's give you a couple of examples here if we can. Let's go back here to 2 Samuel. Well, we'll just give this to you and then not waste time going back because we want to get a lot more things in. In 2 Samuel chapter 11, or in chapter 11 and 12, you remember that David, who was the king of Israel, had instead of leading the army out to the front battles, he stayed at home, and over here very close to him on the balcony was a beautiful woman called Bathsheba. If David had been where he should have been, he wouldn't have had the temptation, but he wasn't. Here's Bathsheba, a very beautiful woman. She was married. And she had a husband. Uriah was his name. David looked at her and the lust of the flesh just began to well up. Boy, I got to have her. Man, I've never seen a woman so beautiful in my life. David sent Uriah, her husband, out to the front lines, called his men in and said, you take her husband, put him on the front lines in battle, and then when the battle really gets going hot and heavy, you withdraw so the enemy will kill her husband. It's exactly what David did. And then he went and he had adultery with Bathsheba after he had planned, premeditated, to kill Uriah, her husband. Now, the point is, was David living like a child of God? I wouldn't think so, would you? Or was he living like the devil? He was living like the devil. He was enticed through the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, and the pride of life. He must have considered himself a macho man. I can get another husband's wife. His ego must have been running high. But anyway, one of his men that God sent to him, he gave him a description and a situation. Now, David pronounced judgment on him right away, and the man said, you're the man, David. Oh, my, you're the man. Now, we're going to find out if David lost his salvation or what he lost. So go with me to Psalms chapter 51, where we have David's prayer. Let's go here to Psalms chapter 51, and we have the prayer that David prayed. Now, we're just showing you this to show you that you don't lose your salvation, but you can surely lose the blessings of God upon you. You most assuredly can. All right, we come over here, Psalms chapter 51. And I'd like for you to notice here. We begin here in verse 5. David, in his prayer now, pouring out, after he had committed adultery and first-degree murder, he was the most miserable man alive on the face of the earth. He's talking to the Lord and confesses that, behold, I was shapen in iniquity, and in sin did my mother conceive me. That means he recognized he has the old sin nature, just like you and I. We got it from Adam and Eve. It's been passed on to every parent ever since. Then he goes on, behold, thou desirest truth in the inward parts, and in the hidden part thou shalt make me to know wisdom. Purge me with hyssop, and I shall be clean. Wash me, and I shall be whiter than snow. In other words, forgive me, Lord, for this tragedy and this gross sin I've committed. Make me to hear joy. I'd circle joy in my Bible, because David never lost his salvation, but he lost the joy that salvation produces, and gladness, that the bones which thou hast broken may rejoice. I feel like every bone in my body aches and is broken because of the sin that I did. Then he goes on, create in me a clean heart, O God, and renew a right spirit within me. Cast me not away from thy presence, and take not thy Holy Spirit from me. Notice in verse 12, restore unto me the joy of thy salvation, and uphold me with thy free spirit. I want to get back in verse 13 to teaching thy ways, and sinners shall be converted unto thee. What David lost was the joy. Hebrews tells us there in chapter 11, when he begins to give the great men of God down there, the great faith chapter, he comes to Moses, and Moses said, you know, he refused to enjoy the sin for a season to be called Pharaoh's son. Or there. There is pleasure in sin. In cases, there's a lot of pleasure in sin, but it's only for a season. David had pleasure in his adultery. David had pleasure in his pride that he could take another man's wife. David had pleasure that he had the power to have her husband killed. But David had no idea the price he was going to have to pay for that. It wasn't that he lost his home in paradise with the Lord, but he lost just about everything that he loved here upon the face of the earth. When you go back to 2 Samuel chapter 11 and 12, the son that was born out of adultery to Bathsheba and David, God said, I'm going to take your son, you're not going to enjoy him. And God did take the son. Then after that, his own son by the name of Absalom rose up against him and tried to steal the kingdom from him and pursued him and so forth. And then Absalom, in fleeing under some trees and that, got his head caught in one of the branches there, killed him, hung himself, killed him. David said, oh, Absalom, Absalom, to God I would have died for you. He loved Absalom so much because he lost that son. And he never had the power in the kingdom that he did have prior to this ordeal with David or with Bathsheba and Uriah. What did he lose? He lost his power. He lost his joy. He lost his respect. But he didn't lose his salvation because God is not a liar. You are kept by the power of God unto salvation, not by your own good works. Now, let's go on down. Let's look at somebody else. Go back with me to Genesis. Mark this one down. Here's Lot. Here's a man who was a Christian, Lot. Clear back in Genesis chapter 19. Lot was a Christian, and yet he believed God. But there isn't anything in Lot's life at all that would ever indicate that Lot was saved. You would look at Lot and thought, man, he's as lost as a goose in a caboose in a Cleveland blizzard. You thought, man alive, nothing in this guy. That's why we can't always judge who's a Christian and who isn't. Now, what Lot lost was everything. He went in with blessings. He went in with a lot of cattle. And he ended up, when he came out of Sodom and Gomorrah, he ended up in a cave with his two daughters. So he went from riches to rags, didn't he? He surely did. But he sunk so low. We go here to Genesis chapter 19. You begin to notice here in verse 5 and 8, he had two daughters that were virgins. In Genesis chapter 19, verse 5 to 8. And anyway, the angel of the Lord had come to visit Lot, and another man had came there, and we find out that since Sodom was completely saturated with homosexuals, that any kind of new man that entered the city, they would come and try to get him. Man, this is fresh meat. I mean, come on now. We're going to find out about him. We're going to get him in and turn him into a homo here. And this is what we're going to do. So they came to Lot's house because they seen the two men that came there. And in verse 5, we pick it up. And they called unto Lot and said unto him, where are the men which came in unto thee this night? Bring them out unto us that we may know them. That means intimately. Intimately. And Lot went out at the door unto them, shut the door after him, and said, I pray you, brethren, do not so wickedly. In other words, your wickedness in sodomy and being a sodomite. But yet, Lot turned around and did something just as wicked as them. And we're going to see what it is. And he said here, in verse 8, behold, now I have two daughters which have not known men. They were virgins. But let me, I pray you, bring them out unto you, and you do to them as is good in your eyes. Only other these men do nothing, for therefore came they under the shadow of my roof. You mean to tell me, you just said, do not so wickedness in your wickedness there, you sodomites, but I'll take my two daughters who are virgins, and I'll throw them out to the wolves, and you guys do with them what you want to do. Lot, you sunk lower than them, wouldn't you say? Now, who would have ever thought that a man was a Christian that would do something that low, that dirty, and not even love his own daughters, who were virgins, and turn them out to this pack of sodomites? That's about as low as you can get. Would you agree? But Lot was saved. This is how far a man can go, serving the flesh, even though you're a Christian, but refusing to follow the leading of the Holy Spirit. You can sink as low after you're a Christian as you did before you were one, if you do not grow in the grace and knowledge of the Lord Jesus Christ. Now let's go back and find out about Lot, all right? 2 Peter chapter 2, verse 7 and 8. Let's go back to 2 Peter chapter 2, verse 7 and 8. Okay, here we go. 2 Peter chapter 2, in verse 7 and 8. Had it not been for the New Testament, we would have never known that Lot was saved. They say the Old Testament is in the New contained, and by the New, the Old is explained. So we get some information here about the Old Testament that we didn't know before. So in 2 Peter, here we go, chapter 2, verse 7 and 8. It says, and delivered just Lot. So he said, Lot, get out of here with the filthy conversation of the wicked. For that, underline this now, righteous man dwelling among them in seeing and hearing vexed his righteous soul from day to day with their unlawful deeds. Righteous man? There's nothing in the Bible righteous about Lot. But positionally, he did believe God. But he didn't practice what he believed. He's still a righteous man positionally now. He never lost his eternal life. But he lost everything. If you go back and read the 19th chapter, you find out Lot lost everything. His wife, he lost and everyone, his sons-in-law to the Lord. And he ended up in a cave. It's sad to see a Christian doesn't realize that you can lose the joy, you can end up with nothing, and you can be one of the most miserable people alive on the face of the earth if you serve the flesh and not the spirit. Now we go on down and look at that. Now, we come on down. Practically, they would appear to be children of Satan, wouldn't they? Let's go back here now to 1 John. How did they manifest themselves? As what? Children of Satan, didn't they? We wouldn't know they were saved. We have a lot of Christians like that today. They appear to be living like the devil. And a lot of them are. Are they really saved? Yes, they're still saved. Now, let's go on down, if you will. In this, the children of God are manifest in the children of the devil. Whosoever doeth not righteousness is not of God, neither he that loveth not his brother. We look at the last part of this. The last part says, that he might, where are we at here now? Verse 10. Whosoever doeth not righteousness is not of God, neither he that loveth not his brother. All right? Now we come on down. What causes a Christian to do unrighteousness and not love his brother? What is it about a Christian that doesn't do that? Well, that's sort of interesting, because all of us are as capable of doing unrighteousness after we're saved as we was before we're saved, because we still have the old nature. Now, let me point out something in John chapter 3, verse 3 and verse 7. When the Lord said, except a man be born again, that means born from above, he cannot see the kingdom of God. He has to be born again. Now, the reason for that is, if there's any way God could have ever remade the old nature that you were born with, he would have done it. And if he could have reformed it without Christ dying on the cross, he would have done it. But this old nature is so corrupt that it will raise its ugly head and erupt at the most inopportune time. It can be very embarrassing to us. It could be this afternoon. You might leave church this morning. Go home this afternoon and something cross your thinking or something, and pretty soon you're in a yelling match. Where'd it come from? Did it come from the Holy Spirit of God that sinneth not? No. It came from that old nature that you were born with. David said, in sin did my mother conceive me. And that old nature, you and I are very aware of, is still with us. And it's so corrupt that God never even tried to remake it or patch it up. But he said, I'll give you a new nature. And that new nature and the Holy Spirit is so powerful that if you'll listen to it and you'll follow it and you'll obey it and not quench it, then you'll have happiness in your life. But that old nature is powerful, but God said, greater is he that's in you, that's the Holy Spirit, than he that's in the world. Now, Satan appeals through the lust of the eyes, the lust of the flesh, and the pride of life. In other words, it's all wrapped up into this, my pride. My pride. That person didn't treat me right, I'm not going to treat them right. The Holy Spirit has a different opinion of that. But let's go on down now, and we find out here the flesh and the spirit have a conflict. And that conflict is the Holy Spirit wants you to love the unlovable, and that's what he's talking about here. He said, neither he that loveth not his brother. He's talking about a brother that's unlovable, because he wouldn't have to tell us to love our brother if the brother was a nice brother, because we would do it naturally. So it's got to be somebody that's hard to love, somebody we really don't like. Their personality just sort of clashes with ours. Their looks I don't particularly like. Their attitude I don't particularly like. And after all, they're just one of the coldest people that I've ever seen. I don't really trust them, but they're a Christian. God says, that's the kind of person I want you to love. Ooh, be-doo. Makes good preaching, tough living, doesn't it? Like I told John in the book of Revelation, take this little book and eat it in your mouth. It'll be sweet in your belly. It'll be bitter. Good preaching, tough living. But that's what the Holy Spirit wants us to do. Something unnatural. Now, I want to show you something here, because you can't do that unless you're born again. Only the Christian can lead the Christian life, not the lost person. In the Greek language, there are three words for love. So when we come on down here, in verse 11, for this is the message that you've heard from the beginning, that you should love one another. There are three words in the Greek. Only two of them God uses in the Bible. There's a Greek word that is spelled E-R-O-S, eros. And that word in the Greek literally means it's a love that has to do with sex. The Greeks knew that, and they used that. It refers to sex and erotic love. Eros was their god, and Aphrodite was their goddess. And the worship of both always involved sex. There's another word. Now, God never put that word in the Greek New Testament. You will not find it anywhere. If you go back to the original manuscripts, you'll never find that God ever used eros as far as putting it in the Bible. There are two other words in the Greek that are used. The next one is philia, P-H-I-L-E-O. Philia is the kind of love that you can have naturally, but not supernaturally. It doesn't extend that far. Philia is a brotherly love, and that's a love that has its limits to the fact that if you like me, I like you. It's a brotherly love that you can have out of friendship. You can have it that way. In Proverbs 18:24, it says, if a man is to have friends, he has to show himself friendly, and there is a friend that sticketh closer than a brother. So you can have a friend that, in this kind of friendship, filial love, that you just bond to and so forth, and actually be closer to you than your blood relation. Maybe some of you have experienced that. Now, that's filial love. But that love has its limitations, because if that friend stabs you in the back, you're not friends any longer. That love says, if you like me and do nice things for me, I like you and do nice things for you. But if you try to rip me off, filial love stops right there. That's about as far as filial love will go. There's a third word in the Greek language called agape. Now, agape love is the kind of love that transcends the natural love we have through friendship. Now, agape is spelled A-G-A-P-A-O, agapeo. And the only one that can have agape love or agapeo love is a Christian, because this is a supernatural love that transcends your natural love that ends when somebody dislikes you. So you have to have something supernatural, and this agape love is given to you in the person of the Holy Spirit that lives within you, that will have you do things contrary to the nature that you were born with. That's agape love. You cannot love those that despitefully use you unless you have agape love. How many of you ever had somebody stab you in the back? Maybe you ever do that. We all have, haven't we? I'll tell you what. You'd like to place the glory of the Lord right on their nose, wouldn't you? But then you stop and think, maybe they'd like to place the glory of Satan on mine. So you take a second thought to that. You know. But how many of you have had a friend and they're not your friend anymore because of something they did? I'm like that. Anybody like that at all? Well, I've got a couple honest people in the congregation. God forgive the rest of you. No, I'm just kidding you. I think we've all experienced that. maybe had a friend, they did something, and your friendship no longer is there anymore. Agape love is loving that person who did something to you and not hating them, but still loving them. You can't do that naturally. And the Holy Spirit wants you to extend God's love to you, right on through you, to them, because God loved us while we were a sinner. And since we're saved, we need to go ahead and love those that are sinning against us the same way God loved us while we were against Him. That's the Holy Spirit. And that is the agape love. Now, in your Christian life, there's a great conflict. Now, let's go back here to Galatians chapter 5, verse 17, so that you understand this. And it will help you understand 1 John. In 2 Corinthians here, or Galatians, I'm sorry, in Galatians, here chapter 5 and verse 17. All right? In Galatians chapter 5, verse 17, a verse quite familiar, when Paul talks about back here the conflict that we have. All right? In verse 16, he says this. Now, we'll go back up here in verse 15. If you bite and devour one another, take heed that you be not consumed one of another. Now, this I say, walk. Now, the word walk, you need to circle in your Bible, and it means be controlled by. Be controlled by the Spirit, and you shall not fulfill the lust of the flesh. So we've got a real battle here. The Holy Spirit wants us not to bite and devour one another, but take heed that you be not consumed one another. Don't be getting in these battles. What should we do? Back off and just love them and go on. Now in verse 17 it says, for the flesh lusteth against the Spirit, and the Spirit against the flesh, and these are contrary one to another. Now look up here just a second. Here I'm really two people as a Christian. Now before I accepted Jesus Christ, I didn't have the Holy Spirit of God. So therefore, I operated out of the old nature that I was born with. And in sin did my mother conceive and bear me. So I got this old nature from Adam and Eve, and that's the only thing I'm operating out of. But now when I trust Jesus Christ as my Savior, I've got the new nature, and the battle rages. The first thing I get tested with is, well, let me give you an example. I trusted Christ as my Savior. It wasn't just a very few days after that, I got a call from one of my buddies, and one of my buddies was having a birthday party down at the bar, and all of the beer was free. Max, you got to come. I went. Ooh. Would anybody thought me sitting there at the bar that I was guzzling beer with the rest of the beer guzzlers, that I was a Christian? Not really. If another Christian had come in, he said, man, there's a child of the devil, because I was living like that. I was telling lies just like they were. I'll tell you, if I was ever going to enter the biggest liar in the world, I'd give me somebody that sits at the bar and drinks beer. I can tell some whooper duper doppers there, I'll tell you what. And then I could tell them too. We all sat there and do that. On the way home, I was inebriated, way too much to drink. And luckily, I made it home without getting stopped by the police, or I'd have been charged with DUI or DWI. But on the way home, I remember I'd had so much to drink, it looked like the cars coming down the road had six headlights. I mean, they were all over the place, and I was having a hard time standing on my side of the road. And if I remember right, one other car sort of had to weave off and go on the berm to keep from hitting me head on. And there was another person inside of me that was started to talk. It was the Holy Spirit. I said, Max, you did a stupid thing. Now, if you plan on, I'll never take away my promise, you are saved and you have eternal life. You have that. I'll never take that back. But if you plan on living this way the rest of your life and making an absolute mockery out of me, the next time I'll just take you on home. Maybe we'll have a car wreck and I'll just take you on up here to heaven and use somebody else in your place. Well, that got my attention because I wasn't ready to go home. I wasn't ready to die. But here was one force, the old nature, saying, hey, don't give your buddies up out here. Hey, now you're having too much fun now. You know, these are your high school buddies now. Now, you know, you can't let these boys down. And that was the flesh Giving his eye. You know, if you don't like me, I don't like you. An eye for an eye, a tooth for a tooth. But you know, after all, Max, you got to have a little fun. I know you're married and so forth like that, but your wife understands. After all, she'll go out with the girls, you go out with the boys. You gotta have a little fun. That was the case that the flesh presented to me. But then the Holy Spirit presented its case. Go with me to Romans chapter 5. Will you? Just turn in your book to Romans chapter 5. In Romans chapter 5, we notice in verse 8, and the Holy Spirit was saying, Romans 5, 8, don't you remember, Max, that God commended his love toward us, you particularly, in that while you were sinners, Christ died for you? Don't you remember that? I don't want you going out there drinking and setting and lying and doing this and getting your eyes wandering where they shouldn't wander and everything else and all this kind of stuff. And we find out in Ephesians 4:30, it was like the Holy Spirit saying, says, grieve not the Holy Spirit, for you're sealed until the day of redemption. Grieve him not. It was like the Holy Spirit saying, please don't break my heart by following the old flesh that's trying to destroy your life. Here was the new nature pleading with me, don't go back to that bar again. Don't drive home drunk again. You may not survive the next one. So there was quite a battle going on, just like you have in your life, and you'll have it until the rapture comes, till you get a new body where the old nature won't be there anymore. But until the rapture, you have an old nature that says, come on, and he'll appeal to you through the lust of the eyes, the lust of the flesh, the pride of life, and the new nature says, please don't grieve me. God has so many blessings for you. Put him first. And there's a clash right there. Satan will do anything he can to keep you out of church because he doesn't want you to hear the word of God, which is going to help you to grow and understand your Christian life. I see our time just about gone. I have a decision to make, and the Holy Spirit wants me to make it according to Romans chapter 6, verse 13. So let's look here while we're in Romans chapter 6 and verse 13. He says here, neither yield ye your members as instruments of unrighteousness unto sin, but yield yourselves unto God as those that are alive from the dead, and your members as instruments of righteousness unto God. Now go back with me to 1 John chapter 3, and notice here, if you will, in verse 10 and 11. In this, the children of God are manifested. That means we're going to show ourselves as a Christian, and the children of the devil, or we're going to show ourselves as a child of the devil. Yes, we're still saved. Whosoever doeth not righteousness is not of God, it's not of the Holy Spirit, neither he that loveth not his brother. That's of the old nature, the old flesh. And then in verse 11, for this is the message that you've heard from the beginning, that we should love one another. Hardest thing in the world is to love somebody that hates you. Hardest thing in the world is to love somebody that has stabbed you in the back. Hardest thing in the world is to love somebody that lied about you. Hardest thing in the world is to love somebody that stole from you. Or said, here's a good deal, and then ripped you off. And so forth. Love doesn't mean you have to run up and throw your arms around them, but it does mean, I don't hate you. I'm not going to try to get back at you. I'm not going to hurt you. And I don't wish anything bad happens to you. I'm going to pray for you that you'll get your life in line with the Lord Jesus Christ so God can use you. And then, this is the Holy Spirit saying, this is how I want to control your life. And then and only then can you have the peace of God that passeth all understanding. This is what 1 John is teaching. Now, we're going to stop here. Because next week, we're going to find out. We'll just look at one thing, and then we'll go in. Not as Cain means, why would John say not as Cain if we wasn't capable of doing what Cain did? He killed his brother. You as a Christian are as capable of doing anything after you're saved as you did before you're saved, because you have that same old nature. And it never changes. It'll always want to get you into trouble by appealing to your intellect, lust of the eyes, lust of the flesh, the pride of life, and the pride is the main thing. The Holy Spirit says, let it go. Pray for the person. Don't ever try to get back at them. And God says, I want to use you and I want to bless you. And I'll tell you, when you do that and follow the leading of the Holy Spirit, you won't need Darvocet. You won't need an aspirin to get a good night's sleep. You'll have the peace of God that passeth all understanding. And a good night's sleep is usually predicated upon a good conscience, where you can lay down and not be thinking about something you shouldn't be thinking about because you haven't forgiven somebody for what they've done. Not always now, but a lot of it is. Let's just bow in a word of prayer. All right? With our heads bowed and our eyes closed, if you've never received Jesus Christ as your Savior, then you don't have eternal life, and God wants you to trust Him. And we just ask you to bow your head for your own privacy. Dear Lord, I know that I've sinned. Well, everybody in the world has. I want to receive you as my personal Savior. Thank you, dear Lord, for dying on that cross for me. Thank you, dear Lord, for giving me eternal life. I know I'm going to heaven because you paid for my sin. If you're a Christian, then you might pray. Dear Father, I have an old nature, and sometimes it raises its ugly head. But I pray, dear Father, that you will help me to grow by learning your word, yielding to the Holy Spirit. And then, dear Father, we can walk in the light as you're in the light and have fellowship one with another. Father, we're grateful to you. Bless each one here. Give us a good day. Hope we can have a good turnout tonight. In Jesus' precious name, amen. All right.